Okay. The first quote is playing. Playing is the sexualization of the trauma. The second is, what is sexualization if not the ability to turn a trauma into a joyful experience? I'm referring to kids now. You can take notes and ask, of course, and you can interrupt me anytime, I repeat that. The real phallus is a metusiosis of your act when your body becomes the ousia. Neither a body, okay, a body of desire, what we called at the time the ergon, which is a word that you can take it as ergon, but also it's erg, it's a unit that they measure something in power and physics, I think, and on, being. So neither concerning the ergon, the being of desire, the being of the act, this being is neither of the other nor the same, but of the alien. The alien's body is a breath. The breath is plasma. I'm referring here to, I think there are four types of ili, of substance, and plasma is one of them. Thunder is made of plasma. In the monad that is built around the pi, the Greek letter P, and the object A, and not the object A, there are straight lines. I want to remind those who have read this seminar that Lacan speaks about non-existence of straight lines, but in my opinion, in the way at least I have read the seminar, he's contradicting himself in the way I perceived what he was saying. And I'm not saying that to say that he is false or something, but contradiction, it's a good moment for us to see Lacan's own unconscious as well, the same he did with Freud. Okay. The alien's body, the breath, the breath is plasma. In the monad that is built around the pi, the P, and not the object A, there are straight lines. Language, but with you, referring to lungs and the object breath that I keep referring lately to my seminars. Language is the voice of the word, but it is not universal. Okay? If it was universal, sometimes I would give some explanations to assist you to think further. If it was universal, then we would have been speaking of a collective, of something that is collective, and the unique experience and the possibility of a unique creation and a unique act in life would not be possible. Jung spoke about the collective unconscious, and for him it was some sort of a replacement of a god, of a deity, of a special power. Okay? Those who follow my seminars, they know that I kind of shifted what was said by Lacan, that the true atheist does not say that God does not exist, but that God is unconscious. I shifted the idea of God, of the unconscious, let's say, in order to add the dimension of the act. Okay, a God powerful who exists, all powerfully speaks, but he cannot act. And because he cannot act, the act falls on the subject. Okay, even if the subject goes to speak about the unification with the world, there cannot be harmony unless the subject acts. And what I mean by harmony, I'm referring to structures and the ancient Greek dimension of harmony. Maybe you know it, but when they were building their amphitheaters or anything in space, they tried to build it in a way that would be harmonious with the lines and geometry and beauty of the place. They didn't want to build it there as a foreign body. It was, in a sense, a foreign body that could be exist in this natural scenery. So it was, besides being beautiful in the eye, they try also to use, let's say in the amphitheaters, they used their knowledge of architecture, but of space, to elevate the voice, okay? Monad is a concept developed by Pythagoras, but in the teaching here, it's referred as that to which is built after the subject leaves his or her body, the Borromean knot body, which is built around the object A, to facilitate a life in the monad. Okay? Playing is foreclosed when the concept of death is denied. The ideal and the identifications come forth with the construction of the north. The ideal brings in immortality, and thus playing is lost. I believe there is a connection with playing and the idea of immortality. And I will add a quote here with, I think I've said it recently from Nietzsche. It is the slave who chooses how to live. The freeman chooses how to die. That is not a suicide, but a way to reach your death. Okay? You choose how to live in order to reach your death. So the play is foreclosed when the concept of death is denied. In order for playing to have access, and I'm not talking about the initial playing that I mentioned, that is a sexualization of the traumatic, okay? And that ability of the child, will have further use later in their life, especially when they have access again to the idea of death. Playing is related to desire. The kakon, I'm using the word kakon from the ancient Greek philosophy, and I think it was Plato who was using the ophelimon and the kakon. The kakon is a true name in the juices of the other. Okay? It is the juices of the other that names the kakon, because immediately creates binaries. Desire has nothing to do with evil or kakon or... It was very difficult to articulate my desire, some people say, because there was a dimension of evil. And that's why a lot of people who confuse juices and desire, analysts as well, they say they are afraid that, they even suggest the analysts, when they have access to their desire, not to fall into acting out. I totally disagree with this idea, because there cannot be an acting out when you're facilitating your life in the dimension of your desire. There cannot be an acting out because there is no object, there is no fantasy, in the sense that it used to function before. Straight lines do exist when the act becomes one with truth. It is where the subject verb moves, but those lines are perpendicular. Again, I'm referring to a lot of statements by many psychoanalysts, including Lacan, although in my opinion, elsewhere, without mentioning the word straight line, he speaks about straight lines, especially when he speaks about the moments of passing the threshold and knowing what to do with the real. There are straight lines there. Straight lines do not exist because the signifier blocks our access to straight lines. The signifiers, the master signifiers, and that are constructed around the object A to give us a being, a substance, a body. Straight lines are prohibited by the master signifiers providing a body. If we choose to fuse, to create a body based on the on, well, not if we choose, that's what our religious body, then the master signifiers are like pillars in space, where with them we shaped our bodies. Okay? The dark matter is present when one transmits desire. It is experienced as an anxiety by those who are crusaders of a body provided by an ideal founded on the death of desire. Okay? There is anxiety when you experience this matter of desire, when you are locked. In the sessions, you will understand that when, after the first sessions, which you can be aggressive in what sense to touch upon their conscious. If people are persisting with their symptoms, or they don't accept, I mean, they don't have to accept it, but if they don't accept it and they persist with the symptom, then they are asking you to enter their fantasy as a master, for example, or someone who gives solutions. And this is exactly what is not psychoanalysis. Okay? It's different to for your voice to be articulated, especially with people that they just started analysis, but not to constantly give solutions at the level of the symptom. Okay? Desire or death. There are two ways to exist. Well, there's only one actually, the way of desire, but to live in the world, you can live with your symptom or any other ways that you can discover. But if you want to be free from the second death, then maybe we could lack we could add here the third death. The third death is when you are living without your act. Okay? You can live without your act. That's the third death. If you ask me, there is only one dimension of life into this. If you experience your cause of desire, let's say different levels of life, because at the end of the day, it's up to the analysants to choose. In what the way they will be facilitators of life. Even if they choose their symptom in the initial form. So death or desire is what I suggest. In the story of Babel, the Tower of Babel, the issue was not that much that they could not communicate with each other, but that they could not communicate their desire with its act. And thus, the lanthanus of desire, okay? I think Lacan calls it the latus. I use the word lanthanus. Was created, and thus the lanthanus of desire was created, and the communication with the other was born. The lanthanus, the other with capital O. The lanthanus was the body event, okay? To have a desire that is not an actual desire, but it's a sort of jouissance, it's a body vein, it gives us a body. All jouissances, they provide us with a body. The act is the body eventualization. Having released your, because of your desire, having released your being from the body of the signifiers, then you have access to a desire that is related to the act in the breath. And this is the jouissance that Lacan calls the mystical jouissance or the feminine jouissance. So this is, for me, this access to the act is the body eventualization. It's not a body event, it's a body eventualization. Because you actually have a body, it's like Phoenix in a sense. Okay, you have a body for a moment. That's why the substance there is like the plasma. It's close to the experience of the awakening. So body event and the body eventualization. When there is desire, there cannot be kakon. I wrote this quote in reference to the big confusion existing between jouissance and desire. When there is jouissance, excluding the jouissance that is mystical because it's a jouissance beyond the body and thus it is beyond the signifier in the way we know it of marking the geometry of a body. What's a body? So this sort of desire is beyond the kakon, is beyond the binary. The breath, the act and the ousia, okay? There are three stuff here. Lacan was speaking, Lacan's favorite number was four. In a lot of seminars, he explains a lot of matters of psychoanalysis in terms of four. And I want to remind you that he was educated in a school of Jesuits. And I said it a couple of times that Freud was Jewish, Jung was Protestant, Lacan was Catholic. And now we're forming psychoanalysis based on a different background. And I'm talking, of course, the Greek background, but also the background of the Trinity. I'm using these religious words, but of course, as you know, we have nothing to do with religion. We're just trying to find the proper discourses to explain certain phenomena. And we are borrowing from other disciplines or discourses. Okay. The breath, the act, and the ousia are one, but they need a body. We will provide the body. That's the body of the act. The subjects operate with the pleasure principle. Okay, in the way Lacan explained it. It is our limit, each one has its own. As to which extent do we desire, do we get pleasure, let's say. And the excess, he named it the death drive. Actually, Freud named it the death drive, but and many analysts after Freud, especially one in, who was a keeper of Freud's archives in New York, he was like Tertullian. If you read the early church fathers, there was Tertullian who was like him. He was believing, for example, in the resurrection of the dead, but that they will have a normal body. So this guy, along with another group of people, these psychoanalysts, he believed that the death drive was inborn, was on the body. You were born with it, which is very stupid, at least for a person who wanted to appear as clever. The subject operates with the pleasure principle. That's very important, what I'm going to say. The subject operates with the pleasure principle. The verb operates on the nirvana principle. Nirvana principle was mentioned by Freud, and he said very little. Actually, if you read his work, he mentions bits and pieces, not on the nirvana principle as such, but things related to the nirvana principle. Something he says on Moses and monotheism, that he speaks about the breath there. And he speaks of the breath as something that is life-giving. And of course, that passage, I cannot recount it now, it reminds us of certain passages in various religions, including Christianity, that God gave life with his breath. And of course, Freud wrote about Moses. I mean, they touch upon these things of religion without getting into the fields of religion, but they borrow some material, as religion did borrow material from the ancient Greeks. So the subject operates with the nirvana principle, and the verb, those of you who follow my seminars, you know that the verb it's a process that I suggest from instead of the subject of their conscious, we are going towards the verbification of their conscious, the process of verbification. And in the process of verbification, to becoming a verb, we've got the ergon, the being of the act. The skeleton soma, Lacan in this seminar, he mentions a couple of other quotes. He mentions a lot of important things, but for today I chose those. He speaks the skeleton soma and the tarichevmenon soma. Of course, he wrote it in, it is written in with Greek Latin characters, but in Greek, but I think they make a, the guy who was typing, I didn't think he heard very well, but the word there is tarichevmenon, is not tarichevmenon, it's tarichevmenon. And I add to these two bodies, the pneumatikon soma. If you want to put it on the Borromean knot in the three dimensions, the one goes on the symbolic, that's the skeleton soma, because it's the symbolic is related to giving a structure. The tarichevmenon soma, that is related to the image, and I will say a few words later. And the pneumatikon soma, which is another term that I borrow from the epistle of St. Paul in the Corinthians. He speaks about the body of the resurrection, as I said many times, and he calls the pneumatikon soma. I bring these things again because of Lacan. He's mentioning these bodies in his seminars, but also because we've got some testimonies from his students that he spoke about. In a response to them, he says about everything is about the resurrected body of Christ. The resurrected body of Christ is that pneumatikon soma, according to the church fathers and the apostles. I will say a bit more about this because I want to put it into psychoanalytic context. What are the differences? This is a question for you. You can write down if you want. What are the differences between the tarichevmenon and pneumatikon soma? Wait, let's fix something here. Yeah, okay. So what are the differences between the tarichevmenon and pneumatikon soma? The pneumatikon soma is called also in the discourses of various religions anastisomenon soma, is the body of the resurrection. I will also want to remind you, it was an article that Angelos Chalidis brought to my attention, I think it was a year ago or 2 years ago, that one of the few things that other schools are talking about the soul of the bodies, and especially about the act, it's very difficult to find anything written about the act, although I consider it perhaps Lacan's most important seminar, in my opinion. It was Miller who wrote an article, and he says in the act, the subject dies and is resurrected. There is a metaphor there. But if the subject is the Borromean knot, and the Borromean knot is a body, then with this sort of the resurrection, you have a different sort of a body. Because this sort of resurrection of being, let's call it being, okay? Those of you, if you had this experience, it is actually as a death and resurrection, because you go through a lot of, you get through, not through a black hole, but through a shithole to get to the spiritual body. I don't remember what I was saying. A lot of things are in my head. I was saying about the differences between the pneumatikon soma is called the anastisomenon soma. And I will tell you an ancient Greek quote that I found in one of the, because Lacan spoke about the body of Christ, so I went to those people who first measured the body of Christ, the first apostles, okay, the first Christians. I wanted to see what Lacan felt, what he experienced, what he saw, and maybe he couldn't say, or he knew how to say it, but he didn't mention it for his own reasons. So I found this nice expression, you can write it down, it's in ancient Greek. It is το αυτό και ουκ αυτό. It is, in a sense, it is that and not that. It is that and not that. Which is, it kind of reminds me different dimensions of existence. Like, I think Lacan mentions also Moses, and Freud mentions Moses. If you know the story with the Ten Commandments, when Moses asked, what should I tell them? Who are you? What's your name? There wasn't a name there. Okay? There wasn't a name. A parenthesis, I'm telling you that the Borromean note is constructed around the subject to create a name. I'm not talking about the proper name that Angelos Chalidis will soon give a seminar on it. It's very interesting what he has to say. But to receive a subjectivity based on a name, and that name is based on identifications. Okay? Based on identifications that most of the times is, if not all, they are not in synchronicity with our desire. So, it is the to αυτό και ουκ αυτό. It's very important. So, who are you? Moses asked him. He says, in Greek, of course, it was written in the ημίον. I am the one I am, basically. Okay? But here, okay, I am the one I am. Very good answer. What is? The answer is, it is. But here, this quote is quite important because it is το αυτό και το ουκ αυτό. It is that which it is, but at the same time, it is not. And it reminded me also one of my favorite quotes from Heraclitus, that he speaks about the Odos Anokato, the upward, downward, in the best case scenario to translate is the upward, downward street. But it's not two, it's one. The best way down is the way up. Okay? You can think of the Möbius strip here as well. But even better to think of what I mentioned in a few other seminars as another object that I introduced besides the breath, and that was the apeiron, not in the term of the chaotic real, but the apeiron as the everything. Okay? So it is το αυτό και το ουκ αυτό. There are two bodies related to the gaze. The gaze, of course, you know, it's one of the object A that Lacan introduced to psychoanalysis. There are two bodies related to the gaze. The two bodies, the skeleton soma and the ταριχευμένον soma, the mummified body. Ταριχευμένον means mummified. And skeleton, skeleton means skeleton. The two bodies, the first two bodies, I'm not talking about the pneumatikon soma, they are related to the gaze. Okay? Remember anorexia. Remember an example that I mentioned many times. When the anorexic looks in the mirror, okay, they see a different sort of a body there. They see the body of I wouldn't call it of the real, but the body of jouissance, the body that is marked by the signifiers without without the emphasis being on the imaginary so much. Okay, there is something more powerful in the imaginary, so they don't see what we will see at that point. The body of the feminine jouissance, the pneumatikon soma, which is for me, that jouissance is the only one I cannot call jouissance but desire. Okay? because it does not provide you with a body. All Jewish essence, all sort of Jewish essence provide with a body, okay? And identifications. This one does not. It provides you with the opportunity to create a body. So we are going from choosing to creating. It's very important, this word creating. The body of the feminine jouissance cannot be captured by the mirror, nor by the trauma. Okay? The anorexia sees the trauma there. Sees the jouissance, basically. Lacan speaks about the mummification. He took a few minutes to speak about the process of mummification and that he put his own daughter to find in Greek dictionaries. He got interested into it. He gives a few details, not so much about the process, but about his interest to find the process of mummification. It is a body purely imaginary that is formed by subtracting the insides. Of course, they kept the heart because when you enter into the Egyptian underworld, you know, the heart is important because they will put it on a scale, and one was your heart and the other one was a couple of morals, and if your heart was higher, you know, it was heavy enough, then you enter something like the paradise, and if it was lighter than the value of these morals, then you enter, I think you went with Anubis, that was the god. So there was a subtraction of the insights. Lacan speaks about that, about the subtraction of the insights. Of course, he's referring to, let's say, the image, the body of the image, the specular image, and what is inside it. He kind of, it's a bit ironic here, he says humor. He says, what one has been eating and why is not taken into consideration. In a sense, what is inside a person and the signifiers and how this outside body was formed is not taken into consideration. The gods of Egypt care about the outside. This fascination with the outside to construct a body purely on the imaginary and to imaginarize the symbolic. And this we can see sometimes with our practice when they bring up their own signifiers or you have an intervention and then they filter it according to that powerful idea that they want to identify with on the imaginary. We can find this in psychosis and especially in paranoia. Or if you don't want to use the word paranoia, I don't like to use it, yet I use it because of, you know, I know some of you are interested about the structures. You can see this phenomena to those subjects that they decide to find a place in life by finding a name according to the formulas of identifications offered in each culture. I'm saying the same thing, but at the end of the day, it's this subject. Yes, the structure might be paranoia or whatever, but at the end of the day, not only the psychosis, but all sort of structures, all sorts of people, they are responsible to, you know, to find their own solutions and how they will live their life. But these sort of people I'm describing now, they decide to find a place in life by building a name according to the formulas of identifications offered in each culture. Let's go to the next quote now. There is no knot in the monad. There is no knot. Okay? There are no knots. There are triangles and there is geometry of motion. I will say a few things later. The triangles and the straight lines, including the hypotenuse, do not offer places of identification, but places where the verb, the subject that became verb, will shine and lost, okay? Before time reaches the one. In this sort of the acts, I said many times that the act is perpendicular. If you have a discord, it goes from left to right, it proceeds linearity. The act is perpendicular. And it's when there is an act, the time it stops. Time stops. And so anything on that moment, it's functioning before time operates, before the one operates. If the one starts operating, then it's a sign that the act went onto the dimension of the doing, and that has happened. This is the first time I will mention this, because the act was lost and the emphasis was given into an identification. So if the subject identifies with something else besides their act, then the act becomes a doing, and then time starts. The act is beyond time. Where the whole and lack were, there would be a sphere hosting the parousia. Okay? The parousia, what you want and what you don't want. Everything is related to your wish, and a wish that at the same time becomes an act. It's not separated from its act. It's a wish that carries a truth plus an act, and this is what desire is. The sphere also has it still operates on the inside and the outside, it's the same, so it's kind of a Möbius, but it's not a whole. I have another question for you. Is the zero the whole? It's Lacan questions. He mentioned that in that seminar. Is the zero the whole? The perpendicular, there was also in these seminars, which it was surprising me because we have been mentioning in the school the word perpendicular in relation to the act. And in this seminar, Lacan, I was very pleased because without knowing about the seminar, we were in the right direction with what we were saying as a school. Of course, he didn't mention the things we mentioned, but he mentioned the word perpendicular. He mentions about different sorts of cuts, the psychoanalytic cuts. And the most important one are the horizontal cut. And I believe this is a cut that, if you see my hand, you can see the graph of desire here. And these are the perpendicular cuts, okay? If the discourse comes this way, okay, so not the perpendicular, the horizontal. The discourse has this graph, Lacan called it the graph of the graph, and Angelos told me is that it was called the graph by Lacan, and then Miller called it the graph of desire. And I think it's better to call it the graph because I don't believe that it represents desire. So the graph was going like this, there was a movement, and then there was a cut horizontal, okay? Those, they can be equated to the interventions of the psychoanalyst. And the other cut is a perpendicular. The perpendicular cut is the act. Okay? It comes perpendicular on the discourse. And the difference between the perpendicular and horizontal cut is that you can repeat the horizontal cut, because in order to achieve a horizontal cut, you must follow the other. You must follow the structures. Okay. So in a way, even if they admit it or not, other psychoanalysts, in a way, it is operating on a knowledge, because in order to get a concept of the other, okay, you must use certain knowledge to understand and have it in mind, and that knowledge is telling you where to cut. That's not a bad practice, by the way, of psychoanalysis, but it's a different one. It's the more classical Lacanian. I would dare to say that we know something more. So the perpendicular cut cannot be repeated. And it cannot be repeated because the analysis search to take each session by session. Anyway, if the subject is a subject of a discourse, then there will be the discourse in front of you, even if you take a session by itself. Okay, and use that also in the interpretation of dreams, or when you touch upon dreams. If you do that, and you don't take other sessions in considerations, you will treat what appears in the dream as signifiers, but it's just part of that context of that day. If you use practicing with the other, I believe you will practice a different sort of psychology, not a creative process. You cannot reach the unique solution. The perpendicular cut and the horizontal cut. The sphere that I mentioned earlier is also the same from the inside and the outside. It is part of the monad, that monad that we mentioned earlier. And I mentioned the monad instead of the Borromean knot. In the monad, as I told you, there are triangles that they can exist with each other. You can even think of them Borromean, but triangles. There are no circles there, but straight lines. Okay, because the body is shaped beyond the signifiers. It's a desire or slash jouissance beyond the signifier. Okay, that's the feminine jouissance. The moment of entering that jouissance, that sort of desire, it is the moment that you will experience the breath for first time. Because you will experience an asphyxiation, and then you will experience the breath in a different way, a new sort of breath. Lacan, there's a quote from that seminar. He says, "Why the hell did I introduce the Borromean knot?" Okay? He said that, before that, he said the sentence that it seems that not many people understand. It was on those lines. He says, why the hell did I introduce it? And then he says, because it has nothing to do with the clinic. Okay, for me, what is this? I think the way he was functioning there, maybe he wanted to take psychoanalysis beyond the clinic, beyond the structures. He hasn't been using the words paranoia, psychosis, schizophrenia, hysteria, obsession and neurosis. These words were mentioning less and less. They have been mentioned less and less in his seminars while he was going towards the end of his life. So, because it has nothing to do with the clinic, what does this tell us? Think about it. Is this what I said about a year ago, that in an interview that psychoanalysis should concentrate on personal development? And I think it was Angelos who added, when somebody asked, not social development, but personal development. Social development is to develop yourself according to specific standards and ideas that are there to be facilitated by everybody. So is it towards a personal development? Maybe the only true personal development, if we are going beyond the clinic. Do we go beyond the clinic in a way that Thomas Sass, the anti-psychiatry and a psychoanalyst, who he says that Freud and Lacan were the greatest psychoanalysts, but they failed to go beyond pathology. They failed to go beyond nominating the subject, even though in Lacanian terms that they use hysteria and neurosis and all this stuff. For me, it is still a failure of associating psychoanalysis with personal development. What is personal development? What do I mean by that? It comes out to how to situate your body in life, but in a way that you are creator, you are going to create your new world. Okay? So it's a trip from the unheimlich to the world. Somebody psychoanalyst wrote recently something about the unheimlich and the world and stuff. And you shouldn't bring the unheimlich to the world. But she was very, very wrong. In my writing, I mentioned it the druid witch. There is nothing aggressive towards her, but I didn't want to mention her by name. So my wish there is for her to become a magician instead of a psychoanalyst, probably. So she said that we shouldn't bring the unconscious into, not the unconscious, the unheimlich, the uncanny, the anikion in Greek, into life, because that would might connect desire with acting out, which is very stupid. I will use a very dated English word that I use, the word simpleton. These are the words of a simpleton. Because this is what actually you should do. You should bring the unheimlich to the world, but the question here is how. You are not going to bring your fantasy and experience the world as such, because that will make you very aggressive and is not going to be very relaxing for you. You are going to bring what you experience there in the unheimlich through your own act. Okay? The unheimlich, it's an uncanny experience, and we've got this uncanny experience because we are ourselves, we are alien to our desire. And desire, what is alien is our desire at the same time. Okay, so you are going to bring the alien in the world after it's not alien anymore. It's alien if you compare it with the other and the universal. Okay. How is the subject reconstructed as verb after the anotti? That's a question for you also. How is the subject reconstructed as verb after the anotti, after the anotti from the Borromean note? To have this feminine jouissance, you cannot have at least constant access to the Borromean note. You have to go beyond those body, that body provided by the signifiers. And this is not the symptom. The symptom does not allow you access to the feminine jouissance. It does not allow you access to the voice of the word, to language with you. Let's go to something else. When the reconstruction, how is the subject reconstituted as verb after the anotti? I use the word reconstituted because I found it in this seminar of Lacan and I liked it. He spoke about the reconstitution. Okay? When the reconstruction occurs and there is access to the breath and the act, then there is no inversion of the subject. There is no inversion of the subject because what is constituted is not associated with the mirror. In this seminar, what I have read just now is quite important. In this seminar, Lacan mentions two or three times that the figure placed in the mirror is inverted. There was this guy that Lacan, I think he spoke as much as Lacan in that year. I think he was some sort of a specialist in topology. But Lacan was questioning him because he was a topologist and he couldn't see the practice of psychoanalysis and the dimension of life that Lacan was bringing to this. So he was speaking in terms of topology as a discipline of mathematics, and Lacan was intervening. In one of his interventions, he said something about the mirror, that guy, and Lacan says, there is no inversion of the subject because what is constituted is not associated with the mirror. Basically, he said there is, when there is mirror, the subject is always inverted. Lacan mentions that the figure placed in the mirror is inverted. You can think inversion as an opposite there. You can think this inversion also as a mechanism in the dream. Okay? It's not only the condensation and the it's not only the metonymy and the metaphor that are operating in the dreams, but it's only the inversion. Okay? And you can see the inversion. The more someone is hold on their jouissance, the more of an inversion there is. because with inversion we are creating not only the double, but we are creating the binary. Okay. So if a figure placed in the mirror is inverted. What he does not say here, what he does not say for his own reasons, good or bad, is that the figure is trapped in the mirror, that a figure trapped in the mirror does not have a known body. Please pay attention to the negatives I use here. Does not have a known body. It is cursed, in quotes, to exist as an opposition, as another. You cannot exist without the binary. If you have no body. Nobody, it's not nobody, but no body, like not having a body. Where there is no inversion and the subject has allowed access to the infinite of creativity, because when the object A is removed and the act takes its place and the monad is formed with the triangles and the straight lines, okay, there is no inversion. Okay, and when there is no inversion and the subject has allowed access to the infinite of creativity, then there is access to the literal and the straight lines. In addition to the metaphor and the metonymy, I introduce, I don't remember, it was in a conversation with Angelos and Penny, I introduce the literal. Well, this is the place of the literal. When there is inversion, there cannot be literal. Anything that is literal there is on dimension, as long as there is inversion, as long as there is binary, as long as there is an object A, the literal does not go, let's call it in the discourse of miracles, if we're going to use a discourse of miracles, and I'm referencing here to the discourse that is not the semblance, it's the discourse of the act, the discourse of miracles, because why I call it a miracle, I'm not saying that you are going to perform miracles, but you are going to perform miracles in quotes by being able to create and making the most out of life. Because you are going to operate on what you want. You will be able to free associate with that. Okay, so I will read again this. When there is no inversion and the subject has allowed access to the infinite of creativity, then there is access to the literal and the straight lines. Otherwise, there would be access to metonymy and the metaphor, to this constant attempt to create the name. Okay? A name based on the confirmation of the other and then gaze. It's a false name because it cannot be the name of the verb. It cannot be a name based on your act. Lacan quotes Picasso, the painter, in that seminar. I really liked it. He says, I do not seek, I find. I do not seek, I find. I want you to see here the dimension of the metonymy and the dimension of the literal, but also to see how the look and being looked and then gaze is used. I find, I see. Okay. I find. I do not seek, I find. This, I believe, is the threshold to the straight line. This I find. When he speaks about the threshold, I think this is the threshold to the straight line. This is the pathways to a straight line. And I'm going to the last quote. The only noting existing later is the verb with the monad. Okay? You connect the verb with the monad. If you want to see it at the level of an awakening, it's the subject being able to speak the language of the world, the language with you. Okay? And I'm talking about the noti because you are connected here. The dark matter of the Ousia ties the particle of being, okay, of the on, of the ergon, with the word. Not word, but with the word. And again, I'm not referring to something that is universal here. It's not something for everybody. Okay, again, I make a separation of the universe and the universal. And from today, maybe we should call the universe, I will use the Greek word, to olon. Not the allon, the other, but the olon. Because when I mentioned earlier the architecture, the structure, different sort of the structure, it was part of the olon, but it had at the same time its own function and its own distinct place. When I mentioned earlier the monad and around the monad, which is a new body formed, which is a no body basically, it is not constructed around the object A, but around the act. And one of my analysts, she's an analyst in formation, I think it was Harula, in one conversation we had, she said, why don't you use the P, the Greek word P there? She wanted to say about the praxis, the word praxis in Greek starts with P. But when she said that, it clicked something in my head that the pi is what we use for mathematics, for the circle, the 3.14. But it does not stop there. It's an infinite number. Okay? But what about to have that pi in the circle of the monad, which includes triangles and straight lines? So that's the new shape I'm introducing today, in which it exists in the dark matter. I gave the P, which is something belonging to a circle, the triangles, the straight lines, okay? No hole, no lack, it's only presence, okay? And a sphere, it's not a circle, the monad is a sphere. Okay, those were the quotes I collected for today. I named who were from Lacan and what were my own thoughts. And I wanted to deliver them to you in the way I did today, bit raw, because I wanted you to cause thinking and urge you to do your own research. I don't have anything else to add, but you can... we can have a conversation or a comment or anything. Penny, Angelos. Can you hear me? Okay. Anybody has questions? Olga?
Hi, Petro.
Hello, Nadia.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hi. I wanted to ask you about, you said earlier, about this access to the voice of the world.
Yes.
Could you elaborate on that a little bit? What does that mean? Maybe I didn't catch it.
Well, it's a language, but I write the term language to separate it from what Lacan mentioned, the la langue, and I use the lang language with you, referring to the lungs, but it's a metaphorical reference to the lungs because I want to give emphasis to the breath, not mm-hmm. object, not as an object of the drive, but as an object of desire.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, when you are going to operate on that dimension, or whoever. For whom life requires that they go to that dimension, to this experience of a I would call it death, in a sense, or and the creation of something new. Then there is a hole where the object A used to be, but it's not a hole, it's a threshold. And mm-hmm. on the body, on the whole of the body, we know about the holes in the body, especially psychosis. It is where, it is from that hole that the breath appears. It is what sustains the unity of that non-body. And your act becomes not an act based on a fantasy or something that was searched by somebody wrote a very interesting comment, but I don't know it's your name. I would like to know who is it. We write in Greek, the Olon. It's in opposition. Sorry, Nadia, just a parenthesis. It's in opposition with the embanda of language. A lot of Lacanians, they use that expression, the embanda of language, that everything is included in language. Karula, yeah. Thank you, Karula. So I will use the Olon with the Greek term. It's time for the French to start using more Greek. Lacan was using Greek. So when you have access to that, whatever, if it's necessary for your life, then the what's supposed to be a hole, it's not a hole, but it's an access. It's an access to the apeiron. The structure is what eliminates the threshold to the apeiron, to your own reformulation. You have a body based on the drive, and you've got a steady point of reference, which is the object A, and then you've got, look at my hand, everything, yeah. Everything, all movements, they pass from there. This is a nothing. That's why I said there is no nothing in that mm-hmm. dimension, because you don't have to pass from the object A, because there is no object A there. There's only the object of desire, which is the breath. Okay, so what is recreated there is not this passage around the same point of reference around the object A, but I forgot what I was saying. Yes, but it is not a recreation of this. Okay, the drive keep operating itself, keep repeating. You know, it's reorganizing. It's the same thing. But it's a reorganization of the point of reference itself. That's why we speak of the act as something that is come and is lost. You cannot make a series of the same acts, because that becomes a doing. So when you are in that dimension, your santom, your sublimation, it's something close to paranoia, but it's not paranoid. You want to contribute. You want to facilitate something much greater than your fantasy, much greater than yourself. And I will use Penny's words to separate this from the paranoia. The paranoid wants to change the world, and the person who is awakened wants to contribute. So you understand, because why this experience of the dark matter of the. Let's say you remove the object A and there is a hole there. It's not an actual hole. You can see it only as a hole because you believe, or people believe, or they're still seeking for this body, this microcosmos of their own fantasy, of the cosmogony of their own fantasy. You experience that as a threshold because you understand how your body, whatever this you have constructed, the place of your desire, is part of something much greater than you. And at first experience, this is quite terrifying. Okay, it's because you are in this hole. You see that there is no hole anymore. It's whole as long as you believe only in your own topology. If you make yourself your topology, your whatever, you can communicate the world with something bigger. Okay, and
so could I say that initially it's like a loophole out of the structure, and then you
you can elaborate on that. And
you can. Yes, it brings a lot of anxiety, and the more anxiety you experience is because you are resisting. Not resisting, it's because maybe the subject either resists or they want to create a solution based on the structure that they have. And that's a symptom. If they go beyond that, then they will have access to this, not Lalang, which is in the Boromia, and it's part of their conscious, but their conscious there will be structured like an act. Desire and the act will be one. Will not be structured like language, but because there will be access to the literal, okay, you will not have the metonymy, so it will be, let's call it the universe of acts. And language there becomes this, the language with you, with the breath, because it facilitates the breath. But it is the language of the world in a sense. You might not be able to communicate with anybody. The best example that I can reveal it is this Gennady Chachenko, I think. It's a Russian-Ukrainian singer, and he sings, he sang in the, I think it was in The Voice or The X Factor. It was Ukraine or Russia, You Have Talent. And he made the song out of imitating voices of the world. And everybody felt calm. Everybody got something, even a message, but he said not even one word. Okay, that's what I call the language of the world. That this person was able to speak the language of the world. Okay, it's closer to the articulations of sounds. They have a coherence. They mark the body differently, but they don't mark it in the same way that they signifies the leaf traits on you or the letters, whatever. Angel will say more about this in his seminar. But in a way that they move the body. That's the language. It's what moves you. What moves you in the morning, but what moves you? Okay, when you can act with that language with you, then you are a being of the act, you are a verb. I don't know if it makes sense what I'm telling you, but in my head it's very clear. Okay, if you want to learn more about it, I mentioned this in other seminars that are online, and also I wrote quite a few things in a book that I will publish in about a month.
Petro. Petro?
Yeah, Lenny.
I have a question. So actually it is a language beyond words.
Yes, if you have a body, if you have a body, at least words in the way we know them with the master signifiers, because and that's not an anathema or a hubris for Lacan. I like to call myself and our school, because sometimes they call us, or they in a sense, they believe that we are heretics. Lacan was a heretic, but we are not heretics of the heretics. We are creators. Okay, you have the dogmatics, in terms of what they say about psychoanalysis. You've got the heretics, which are the Lacanians. We are the creators. Okay, we are
I agree with you in the existence of a language beyond words. That's why I wanted to make sure I understood correctly.
Yeah, it is beyond words in the sense that signifiers to give us a body. They are related to the feminine jouissance. If there is a jouissance that is beyond the body, there is a jouissance, which I call desire, beyond the signifier. So there is a language beyond the signifier. And this is what I call the language of the breath.
So you have a subjectification, which is beyond identifications.
Yes, it's actually a verbification. Beyond identifications. That's a very good point that you brought in. Very good point. Okay.
No, because I was thinking of this identification through genealogical transmission, which goes beyond words. So I really, that's in the sense of how I myself understood things. That's why I wanted to make sure I understood you correctly.
If there are identifications with genealogical transmissions, then you either have to believe in the bodily DNA or to the stories that carry these identifications.
I don't believe in bodily DNA.
Okay. So if they are through a story, still it's through a signifier. Through the language of the signifier. What I'm telling now, there are two sorts of identifications which they are connected. Is the identification with the act and the identification with the breath.
Yeah, but that's beyond.
It's beyond the signifiers, it's beyond the language providing
yes.
a body.
Yes, that's beyond the identification through words or through names.
And through our own narrative, let's say, that marked us from the childhood.
Yeah.
Okay, yes. My answer is yes.
Okay, thank you very much.
Nadia, you wanted to ask something else, or Penny?
All clear, Petro, thank you.
Okay. Corina, Miriana, Katerina, Pantelitsa, Elisa, iPhone. Perime, somebody asked in the chat. How will you write Olon in English? Olon or Holon? I'm not going to write colon for sure. I will write Olon Harulla or somehow differently. So we do not confuse it with anything else like the O other. Well, yeah, that's good. I will write it with the Olon. I think I already wrote it. No, I did. And I wrote the Olon, but with Omega. The first O is Omega. Referencing to the Alpha and the Omega and the letters. Lacan speaks of the letters, which again, Angelos gave a very good seminar. And he will speak again about it. But I'm referring there, the Olon with the Omega. Okay, going to the Alpha and the Omega. Another question on the triangles you have mentioned. What does each anchor of the triangle represent? Okay. The triangles, I want you to think, it's the next seminar that I will speak about the representations, but they are very secondary actually. What is most important is to think. Start by thinking before you have conceptions of the monad. Try to think first of the Borromean knot, tight, but with triangles, not with circles. Why I refer there to triangles? Not so much, it's not about the corners, but the corners are formed because of straight lines. My emphasis was on the straight lines. You cannot have straight lines because I was thinking what Lacan said, but you cannot have straight lines because what a straight line is, the way I think of it at least, I know there could be other arguments, but it's my own path towards the object of my desire, okay? To the breath. That's the object of my desire and facilitates what actually makes me breathe. Not a subject who speaks, but the subject who breathes. So you can touch immediately. Like the, what do I want? You are very clear, not only to say it, but to do it. That's a straight line for me because it is not interrupted by signifiers. What is troubling us is the identifications, but also it's the signifiers we choose to identify with that they stop this access to a straight line. This is what stops playing, which initially was formed to, I'm talking in Freudian terms now, to sexualize the trauma, not to make a sex out of the game, the toy, or whatever we're playing, the playing, but to sexualize the trauma, it means to make the trauma unbearable. And this is the first miracle that the child does, okay, or any person, to make, that's part of the discourse of miracles in a sense, to make the traumatic enjoyable. Okay, and this is what is lost in the process of life. We had recently a quite interesting conversation with Penny and Angelos about this. I remember I did mention it in a couple of seminars, I think it was 2 years ago, but the playing is, it comes first as a sexualization of a traumatic, making the traumatic bearable, and then it will, it's a force, it is part of the force to form straight lines. This, I want that.
Okay.
So that was Spiro's question. I didn't say your name because I thought you didn't want to mention it, but you removed yourself with this. Okay.
Yes, I'm here.
Okay. Question? Penny? Penny?
Something to add on the circle.
Yeah.
It came to my mind some transformation there exists in geometry. I don't remember how this transformation takes place, but it relates to a circle, triangles. And what's interesting about this is that the whole plane, and especially the infinite, the apeiron, becomes the center of the circle in this transformation. So the infinite is included in this circle. And what is, in our terms, what is impossible, it becomes the very point around which everything is constituted, around which the holon is constituted there.
Very nice. The infinite part that you have as center, it's a 3.14. I use it there symbolically because it's infinite. But also what you said now is very important, because what becomes the center of our verbification or subjectivity, it's since there is the apeiron there included in that, it's the apeiron of creation. To create.
Yeah, there is something about creation. The other thing that came to my mind is that in the torus that Lacan introduced, there is a hole there at the center.
Yes.
And he placed the object at that center. Yes. And so there is your question also, is zero the hole? And I remember the yogi that was talking about God and about mysticism and about Jewish tradition. And one Jewish mystic was asked, what are you trying to achieve? And he answered that we're trying to experience the creation of things and ourselves from ion. And this word ion means nothing, but it is also a name used for God. Yeah. And this yogi also referred to the word nihil, that means nothing, but in the medieval tradition was also used for God. So nihil means nothing and it means God also.
Yeah. Well, it sounded like a Gnostic text. They were very interesting people, these mystics. And it has, we can say a lot about this in terms of Lacan's feminine Jewism, which is also called the mystic Jewism. I like your comment.
Can I add something, Petro?
Yeah, of course.
It's in listening to Angelos came to my mind something I was reading recently about modern science as being a paradoxical, based on a paradox. And it's the example of measuring the density of air, which at very, very micro nano levels can become extremely dense or totally empty. So I was just thinking of the whole and the apeiron, eternity and the moment, to αυτό και το ούκο αυτό.
Yeah. Well, I will add to that, to what you said, Angelos, that in this seminar, I'm telling you, Lacan was mentioning the torus. He spoke about the problem of the hole there. And he spoke a little bit about the sphere without elaborating. But if a sphere is there, then what is considered as a knot becomes part of this dark matter, part of the holon. If the sphere is there, then it's because this dark matter of the holon, it's you are connected with that in a sense. There is
The holon is the connection, is the knotting itself the holon?
Yes.
Okay.
It's a knotting. It's the only knotting that exists actually, in the monad. It's the moment that you will provide a body to your desire and to the monad. The other way around, the Borromean knot, it gives you a body. You don't give it a body. It gives you a body.
So on this, I was going to ask that in your quote, there is no knot in the monad. You meant this knotting or the knot, there is no negation.
There is no negation.
And also there is no knotting or it is the knotting. There is no knotting.
There are no knots, and the only knotting that exists is the connection of this provision of the body to desire. Okay, to the dark matter. That's why there is no hole and there is only presence. I use the word parousia, which has the word ousia in it. It's the presence of the ousia. There that used to be a hole, now it's a connection with the olon. And this is, and with this we can speak maybe in another seminar about the true dimension of sublimation. Because they explain sublimation from a trip to the Heimlich to logic. And they, of course, they play with the word logos and logic. But they say it's from the myth of the fantasy to logos and logic. I believe it's the other way around. It should be, of course, from this trip. But when you return, you don't return to logos because you approach the Heimlich with the logos and the logic. And then you return back with your act. Not an acting out, but with your act. And this is where you provide the body to the olon. That's the only knotting. It's a knotting of love, a different level of love, let's say. A love that you will not seek from the other to complete your body, to complete your specular image. And the object there, the fundamental object there is not the gaze, as Lacan mentioned, but is a breath. Because this sort of the body, we use a religious term, pneumatikon soma, of the mystical experience. And those of you who have a lot of sessions, one after the other, if you have like 10, 15, 20 sessions a day, then without you asking for it, you enter that trip. You are not operating with your body. Angele, I don't know if I responded to what you asked, but maybe you can add something. There are no knots. The Borromean, it's a knot. There are no knots because there is no object A. There is object of desire. Okay, but there is one knotting of the verb with the monad. In other discourses, this is the awakening. Okay. And if the awakening appears, but there is persistence on the structure of the Borromean, on the specular image, then it becomes paranoia. Penny, do you have a comment? Anybody? Okay, I have nothing to say. So maybe we can stop it here. Are you okay with that?
I have a question.
Yeah.
But I'm not quite sure about it. But okay, I will...
If you were sure, it wouldn't be a question.
Okay, yeah. it's about the olon. I make an image in my mind, like olon is the universe has stars. And like we connect the stars, can we associate the stars with like a points of reference towards our desire?
Sure, you can construct your own way of naming that. It's I hear that you are trying to make sense of this and you are trying to use different metaphors. So I will not respond as a yes or no, but continue your research.
All right.
Okay, guys, thank you for listening. We might have another seminar of this sort in maybe two weeks. Continue what we're saying here. So you will be informed through the society. Enjoy your weekend.